I'm taking upon myself to ask all of the roasters, the people who are going to be getting up here, to show some respect. Now, having said that, there are a few...
We're here today to honor a man who believed not only that black is beautiful, but that black is flammable. Yes!
You know, as a kid, my brothers and I and my family would always think about what, you know, what was said behind the closed doors of the Friars.
In the past, the Friars Club has honored many great stars such as Sinatra, Hope, Jack Benny, George Burns, but today we've sunk to a new fucking low. Laugh it up, please. I laugh when you act.
Let me in.
No, no.
I hear laughter. Let me in.
No, no.
Open up the door. Oh, let me in.
No, no.
I hear music. I don't wanna weep no more.
A lot of people don't know what the Friars Club means. Its function, its membership, its purpose. Well, you're not gonna get it from me. I'm no stool pigeon.
I always knew there was a place called the Friars Club, which was strictly for men, and in New York, and that it was a kind of a closed enclave.
It was started right after the turn of the century. A group of performers, like George M. Cohan, who was the toast of Broadway, names like that got together and wanted to have a fraternal organization, predominantly show people.
1920 was the first time that I ever went to the Friars Club. Eddie Cantor, like, discovered me. He said, well, I'm gonna take you someplace. I said, where? He said, the Friars Club. He said, I want you to meet the biggies, the heavyweights, the stars. So he took me in and we sat at a table. At that table were really the icons of their days. George M. Cohan, Enrico Caruso. And next to him was the one and only, the greatest, Irving Berlin. Well, you can imagine, a kid 12 years old. I was in awe. And they're passing jokes around and doing ad-libbing and all that stuff. And I couldn't ad-lib a burp after a heavy dinner.
Friar Abbott, brother friars, ladies and guests.
Show business in those days happened in New York. This was before the glory days of Hollywood, the 1930s and 40s. And of course, once the New York-Los Angeles axis was established, it was then probably inevitable there would be a Los Angeles branch of the Friars.
California, here I come, right back where I started from, where bowers of flowers bloom in the spring. Each morning, that dawning bird is singing and everything.
Here's the fellow who started all, Georgie Jessel. Georgie, can you give us a little bit of the history on the Friars?
Very quickly, a little more than 10 years ago, I founded the Friars of California with the aid of all these fine actors and some lay people as well, like Harry Carl and many others. We were able to give more money to good causes than any other social club, I guess, that was ever in the whole world.
It's not like being asked by an outside organization to please sit on the dais. This belongs to us. And we build a building, and it's a lovely building. And if a guy wants to go out and have a couple of drinks or play cards or shoot pool or something, he doesn't have to go downtown anyway. He's got his own place he can go.
That's why I can hardly wait. Come on, come on. Open up, open up, open up that golden gate, California. Here I come.
Friars Club, good afternoon. 57 East 55 between Park and Madison.
Good afternoon, Friars Club. Thank you.
Abbott Emeritus Milton Berle, dial 601, please. Abbott Emeritus Milton Berle, dial 601, please.
I've never come to the Friars where I didn't feel good. I don't know what that is. I don't know that you could even label that.
It's a great place to meet, to talk, kibitz, food's wonderful, good camaraderie. You can't beat it.
People are always really surprised when they see us together. You put 6-7 comedians together, and people are surprised how happy we are with each other, the fun we have with each other, and the caring we have for each other. That's why the Friars Club became a great place, became a mecca for comics, entertainers to hang out.
Okay, 1 o'clock, lunch, Friars Club. Unless you'd rather eat someplace else.
Yeah, off Madonna's breasts. But you gotta call so far ahead for reservations.
That's funny.
Yeah, Berle said I'm not topical.
When you become a comic, your family is all the other comics. When you get together, it's like no other group because they're all full of jokes.
When you sit down and you talk to another comedian, you know the talent he tells you. When I was in Ohio, when I was in here, when I was there, you know these talents because you've gone through them. And you talk about a certain hotel, you talk about a certain restaurant, you know because you've been there. And it's there are very few people you can sit around and talk that intimately with, you know?
We're in the trenches. I mean, this is a real battleground when you're a comedian. The other guys, it's a joke. You want to be a singer? You can blindfold yourself, stick your hand in a grab bag, and come up with George Gershwin or Cole Porter or Irving Berlin or any of those people and sing their wonderful, wonderful songs and recite their poetry. Not with us.
It takes a comedian to appreciate another comedian because he knows what it feels like to stand out there alone.
We're the best audiences for each other. There's not much normalcy to us. We see things twisted. We see things offbeat. That's why we become comedians. So, of course, there is a camaraderie and a fellowship amongst comedians. You don't find very much amongst people in other businesses or trades or creativity or anything like that.
At the Friars Club, some of the favorites listed some of their favorites.
Milton Berle, George Burns, of course, and the great Willie Howard.
And Alan King.
And Alan King.
It would take me an hour, really, because every time you think of one, you think of another.
Bill Silvers.
Bob Hope.
Milton Berle.
Jack Benny.
Buddy Hackett.
You got Jack Lemmon. And Edwin, of course, was a triple threat man.
They said, who's the funniest comedian? I've been asked that. I said, I am the funniest. I remember the night. I also remember the night Red Buttons was the funniest I ever saw. At the Patio Theater in Brooklyn, I saw Jackie Leonard, who was mostly an inside comedian, reach an audience of 1,500. He was sensational. I seen Milton on a night when I wondered, do I have the right to be in the same business? Yes, I'm the funniest. That night, everybody gets a night or a time to be the funniest. We all have, whatever has gotten you to a point where you can make a steady living, standing up and doing your thing in this business, all the guys at the Friars are the funniest.
We have an abiding principle in the Friars, and that's that we never kid anyone we don't love. You
always heard. Well, the concept of the roast is that you honor someone by dishonoring them. The one you shouldn't hurt.
Show business and public life, here New York's Governor Harriman, they turn out to do honor to Dean Martin and Jerry Lewis. It's the annual dinner of the Friars in New York, and only one woman shares the dais.
I was sitting up on the top deck with Marilyn Monroe. That's how big the roast was. And she kept saying, what did he say? Oh, what did he say? Oh, what is the, what does shtick mean?
I was in awe. I mean, celebrities, the dais were people that I had revered, you know, that I'd seen on TV that I never ever hoped to see in person. And they were brilliant.
From Milton Berle, master of ceremonies for the dinner, the Friars' own Oscars, symbolic of top performances on and off stage.
I would have loved to have been at a Friars' roast just any dais from 1950. You know, when I see those, I mean, you know, Jackie Leonard and Rickles and Dean Martin and Jerry Lewis and all those guys, when you see, you know, a bunch of guys smoking cigarettes in a little crappy table with a crummy tablecloth and crummy glasses and a little stupid dais, and, you know, with the little fucking podium, and they're just having a fucking riot.
You walked away just feeling excited, like you're seeing something that the public never sees.
It seems strange to have a roast for a man who did it to himself. Yes. Somehow inappropriate to call yourselves friars, too.
I would say that when the Friars offers to roast you, that you've arrived.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Please join me in welcoming Kelly Preston and John Travolta, our guests of honor, escorted by our master of ceremonies, Larry King, and Jackie Green, producer and chairman of tonight's event.
Something light and fun. Not a roast, you know, I don't expect a roast, but light and fun.
No matter what they say about you during the roast, it's a terrific honor.
Ladies and gentlemen and brother friars, I take a hell of a beating to save this club, don't I?
I was the MC. I hit the gavel and I said, good evening. And a young man, unbeknownst to me, jumped up and said, there goes my opening. Well, it was a big laugh, unfortunately. And I retorted by saying, young man, if there's a fire in here tonight, we leave this room alphabetically.
Milton, when I go to Israel, in your honor, I will have a tree uprooted.
The roast, to me, is the ultimate of great comedy, because you have one subject matter, the woman or man that you're going to roast. And you got to know there's going to be 2 hours worth of people getting up there, and you're in the championship fight of comedy. You are in the championship fight of comedy.
We'll get to you, Milton. As I say this as a friend, the dye in your hair is running.
I worked harder on the 5 minutes at the first roast than I did on my act. And then through the roast, you get the confidence, you know. Then you become one of the boys, you know. And you call Jolson Al, you know, that kind of thing.
They wanted to have a young guy on the dais, and I jumped at the chance. He was at a rehab like 10 days or something. He was in, you know, he flipped his Viper. I mean, you have to put it in the context of this being a very hot ticket. So my opening joke was, poor Kelsey's been in and out of Betty Ford more times than Gerald Ford. What else did I say? I said a bunch of jokes about him having a young girlfriend. I said they have cute little pet names for each other. He calls her his fuzzy little teddy bear. She calls him a big bald cash machine.
I can take it, Larry.
No kidding, man.
Sure, if they say I'm short. They'll be telling the truth.
They might say you're short.
They say I'm bald. They're telling the truth. I love to comb my hair with a sock.
Let's stop and talk a minute about the boyish good looks of Larry King. His Hebrew name is Yech.
In boxing, you have a boxer. Stock is a puncher. Every round keeps after you, punching the flip, makes the crowd scream and yell with, wow, what a great fight, what a great, that's a stalker, bomber. And 90% of the Jewish comics that I know are stalkers.
Our abbot emeritus, of course, was Milton Berle, who is not with us tonight, but I know that he's with us in spirit, just as our jokes will be with him on his opening television show.
You're really swell, Jack. You've certainly developed a nice comedy style mind.
Ladies and gentlemen, I'd like to speak tonight about the generosity, humanity, and the warmth of Ed Sullivan. Thank you.
We are honoring Friday night Hugh Hefner, the founder and publisher of Playboy magazine. A man who once said to Richard Simmons, okay, so read the articles. A man who convinced Anthony Quinn that condoms are for sissies. This man right here, that's why he's getting the dinner. A man who made it possible for premature ejaculators to get Playboy a week early. That's the kind of man that we're giving to. You get the idea?
I appeared at a roast for Gene Kelly just a few years ago. It was a big one here in Beverly Hills. And I said, the phone rang, I picked it up, and I just, hey, is this Jane Murray? I says, yeah, what does Frank want? You know, he gets screams, you know. I says, yes, what does Frank want? I'll let him tell you himself. Hey, Frank, I got Jane on. I says, my God, Frank Sinatra himself is going to talk to me. Isn't that something? And this well-known voice came on. Jan, Frank, Saturday night, Beverly Hills Hotel, Gene Kelly affair. Be there. And he hung up. I says, what a conversation. I said, he never said which Saturday night. But he knew he didn't have to, because he knew damn well that from that moment on, every Saturday night, I would put on a tuxedo, go to the Beverly Hilton Hotel, and look at the bulletin board to see if that's the night of the Gene Kelly affair.
Now, in addition to our magical mystery tour, we're also very pleased to have a report on the Friar's Roast for Frank Sinatra. Now, the Friars didn't want any cameras present at their strictly X-rated dinner, but there was kind of a pre-party attended by all the honored guests.
What do you think of Frank, really?
Well, Frank Sinatra, I tell you, since I was a kid, was my idol. Now that I've matured, I'm fed up.
Well, I think whatever Sinatra is today, has today, he in fact owes to me.
They always had, for Sinatra, the idea that he had, nefarious connections that could hurt you.
What kind of man is he really?
Frank, I tell you, I don't like, you know, this is a roast tonight where we got to spritz and zing Frank. You know, I don't want to do it because I still have relatives living in Jersey.
I'll tell you why we're all up here tonight, and I'll tell you it in one word. Fear.
I know when Johnny Carson was going to MC a Friar's Roast, I'd come into his office for our little chit-chat before the show, and he'd be jotting down things. You know, he'd look at me, he says, oh, I got a joke for the Friars thing. Going to put them away.
You don't know the night that Johnny Carson had to go to the bathroom real bad and sitting on the dais? And he says, I got to go to the bathroom. And I just took the champagne bucket and put it under the dais table, and he peed and just filled up the bucket. The empty champagne bucket.
Do people know?
They knew it later on. You couldn't see from there, except us near him. You could hear the tinkle.
Who's on the dais?
Well, let me see. There's Jack Benny, Bob Hope, Danny Kaye, George Jessel, Martin and Lewis, Danny Thomas, Eddie Cantor.
Oh, gee, that is a lot of talent.
Yeah, but there's one problem. I'm the last one to speak. I hope they don't get to my jokes before I get to them.
I've seen guys sit and tear up cards, you know. They have the material listed on cards, and they keep throwing away cards as the roast goes on.
Oh, there goes that joke. Uh-oh, there goes that joke.
Damn it, that was one of my best jokes.
If I had my druthers, I'd hope. Give me first shot at him, and the rest of you could wrestle after that.
This Bruce Willis one ideally didn't get on. I don't know, it was almost 3:30 in the afternoon, almost 4. And Milton Berle didn't put me on.
I can save this man for this spot because he is dynamite. And we know it. He's also, not you, Jack.
It looked like he was not going to introduce me because he put on Pat Cooper, and I thought, well, I got to follow Pat Cooper. I always do. I close the roast. I'm the closer.
Jack, I'll be with you in 1 minute.
And I see he's now introducing busboys and thanking the hotel and the waiters. Let's hear it for the help. I stood up, I ran over.
Shit.
What do you want me to
put
do?
Put it back in.
Oh, shut up, you.
Put the mic back in.
Oh, fuck you.
Put the mic back in there. Put it back in here.
And I grabbed his cigar and I broke it in half.
Here, Milton, here's your fucking cigar, here.
I said, maybe that'll get your attention. Remember me, I'm sitting over here. I've been here for 7 hours. You think I'll get on, or you're gonna want to do some more busboys? Yeah, you forgot the guy who wrote the invitations. I did, you know, I went crazy, you know. And I'm funny when I'm angry, you know, just give me a theme.
I was like third or fourth up. People were kind of bombing before me. I go on, Uncle Milty, he just shits on me. Every joke, he would stand up and like push me or poke me or heckle me. So that like my performance became half for the audience and half me and him sparring. And finally, Buddy Hackett, who was on the other end of the dais, stood up and he said, you know, in a way off mic, but booming loud voice, he's like,
hey, Milton, let the kid work. You used to.
He knows now. Not to fuck with me. Hackett's got my back.
Let's go Hollywood backstage as the Friars roast Dean Martin. How long have you known Dean?
I just met him a few hours ago.
I've known him a long time. The truth of the matter is, but he doesn't recognize me. I've known him for about 20 years, but he never recognizes me. Drinks a lot.
In all of my years, this long half century, I can't remember any greater impact on an audience as when they see Sammy Davis Jr.
Thank you, Dean. I can only say seriously, may God bless you. And I'm not only sorry you're not Jewish, I'm sorry you're not colored.
And so, ladies and gentlemen, ain't he great, Frank Sinatra?
Mr. Martin, Mr. Toastmaster, honored guests, fellow friars, I have to go to the bathroom. Jeez, I've been sitting here a long time.
And now a few words from the guest of honor, our beloved friar, Dean Martin, ladies and gentlemen.
May I state, it's been great, and the kind of evening few people rate. I've been flattered, but I have to agree, Mr. Wonderful, that's me.
Now that takes guts, right?
The most beautiful guy in the world isn't me, no, isn't Dino. But as we know, it's the man that we honor tonight.
I usually sit in the second row behind the MC and the guest of honor. Carrie never wanted to be in front of a live audience and make speeches or talks or whatever. He was, because he was afraid of it, you know, which is nothing to be ashamed of.
Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Cary Grant.
He got up to talk, and he started to cry.
Thank you very much. That's very kind of you. I don't know how I can follow all that, and probably won't please you at all, but there you are. But you see, I'm still tearful from Frank singing his song to me.
Of all my years in this business, I don't ever remember an audience standing up and screaming their heads off and crying with them. I never saw anything like it before.
But it was of major and majestic importance that the Friars of Hollywood give a dinner. We need money very bad.
Jessel, unequivocally, was the greatest Toastmaster that ever was.
I'm glad I'm finding these impromptu things because I brought with me a speech for a circumcision in Glendale.
I'll never forget on his 79th or 80th birthday or something, and everyone was making a fuss about it, and he says, you know, he says, I reached an age now, I get up in the morning, he says, and I look in the obituary column, and if I don't see my name in it, I call a hooker.
Well, we always had the stags, the afternoon stags. There were no women, though, there at that time. There was no such thing as seeing a woman in there.
I want to welcome you to another Friars Festival of filth and fornication.
Milton is always marvelous at a roast. He's brilliant. He was the daddy. He would do like 40 minutes to begin with and cover every subject and use up every four-letter word. So really, you really had to be clean after that. There was nothing left to say. He covered every graphic, oral opening in the body, every orifice, everything.
Milton Berle's great. Just never give him a sandwich with the crust of the bread on it, or he'll throw it at you.
You don't like the crust.
We all know about Uncle Milty's legendary penis size. I mean, this is a guy who put the word cock in Al the Cocker.
Yeah, that's become more or less traditional. That's always seems to be included in every roast where Milton is visible.
Milton Berle's penis has become more popular than the rest of him.
I'm not saying this thing is big, but it has a beeper. Folks, I'm standing on it.
In order to get some humor and some fun, you got to use language and you got to be naughty.
I thought we should get just a few other things out of the way before we start. Okay. Shit, piss, cum. Ass, asshole, asswipe, butt fuck, gerbil.
If language is not a barrier, it opens up a lot of comedy areas.
Cock. Cock sucker. Prick, dick, putz, schmuck, jerk off, whack off, beat off, fart.
It's not something that you can see on television. It's not something you can see at a nightclub. It's not something that you can see at any banquet or private affair other than the Friar's Stag Roast.
Fuck. Fuck you. Fuck me. Fuck your mother, fuck your sister, fuck a nun, fuck a cow, fuck a sheep, blow the Pope.
A roast gave us a chance, gave the comedians a chance to be funny without any barriers. Because I came from an era where backstage used to have signs that says in a theater, if you say damn or hell, you're canceled.
Well, I think about that about covers it, and I'm sorry, Mayor Dinkins, if I've forced you to rethink your speech.
The first one I ever attended was a luncheon, and it was honoring George Burns, and Jack Benny was the MC. So it was quite a shock, I mean, to walk in and hear Jack Benny on a microphone using very unfamiliar language for Mr. Benny to be using, but with that style.
After all the dirty stuff, by the time I got on, all the friars were playing with themselves. Next banquet, they had shorter tablecloths.
What can I say about Gary? Gary Shandling is a good friend, a wonderful comedian, and the only man I know who fakes orgasm during masturbation.
First of all, actually what I like to do after I masturbate is get up in front of a crowd and tell some jokes. So, this is gonna work out perfectly. This is, as far as I'm concerned, an afternoon for me.
Your attention, our guest of honor, Humphrey Bogart.
I was the MC of that roast. And I was honored and very excited.
This is Lauren Bacall. Yes, Mrs. Bogart, the uninvited guest. You rat bastards.
She sent in a tape, and I remember she was the head of the whole thing. Because she talked naughty, you know? And she said a couple of naughty things that broke everybody up.
I said, Bogey, why can't I go? He said, baby, it's gonna be a little rough. You know how men act at a stag. So that's why women aren't allowed. See? Well, I was furious. In fact, I was goddamn mad. What the hell can the friar say that you haven't called me?
Arnold said, what should I do at the end? I said, well, I wouldn't do much if I was you, because most of the veteran comedians who get up after you roast them and try to be funny, it doesn't work because too much went on before them. But this guy fooled us.
Now, the language we heard here tonight was supposedly very dirty. Well, let me tell you something. It didn't embarrass me at all, because I heard worse language in Hannesport when they found out I'm a Republican.
I didn't come here to get laughs. Anybody get laughs? That's easy. I came here to be honest. I want a fucking job, Billy. I want a fucking job.
He opened the fucking door for us, comedy. He opened shit. And when this is off, I don't want to talk to you no fucking more. You hear that?
What are you writing down? Don't write nothing down, you rat bastard. Don't write nothing down. Get your own fucking writer. Sucker. I ain't got a writer. He's writing my shit down to do on this cocksucker's roast.
Next up is Buddy Hackett. Now, Buddy Hackett, Buddy actually was a babysitter for me when I was a little, when I was just born. He was on the road with my dad in Call Me Mister, and he took care of me. So all of my neuroses we can attribute it to Buddy. He probably dropped me a couple of times.
And I was not your babysitter. Actually, your father and I shared a dressing room, and your mother and him were fucking one afternoon in the dressing room. And if I hadn't stepped on your father's ass, you wouldn't be here today. Some of the greatest wit that you've ever heard, you know, that was X-rated, were done at the Friar's Roast.
You're dealing with, by and large, the best comedy minds in the world, the best comedians. So the language isn't gratuitous. It's not dirty just to be dirty. It's brilliant.
You acted surprised when Meg rolled her eyes. Pretending to come, you were struck dumb. You thought it was lies. But Janice has been doing the same. She moans and groans, but she never came. At least not with you. You're such a bad screw, you impotent Jew.
They didn't want us here at first, you know, the Friars. They didn't want the women to join. That was a big struggle, apparently. I wasn't around then, unfortunately, because I would have enjoyed that fight. But it was, you know, it was the male bastion.
I actually don't understand why they didn't have women for so long. I don't really understand the value in not having them. Like, what fun is that? A non-co-ed club. Because that's part of, like, the fun at, like, at night, especially if you're drinking. What are you gonna do, flirt with the other guys? You know what I mean? Like, get real randy with the other guys you're around. I mean, how much guy-guy talk can you stand?
Well, if you're gay... Whoa.
If you're gay. Whoops. Not a lot of gay friars, as far as I know.
No.
The first woman we ever honored was Sophie Tucker. And the word is still out, if she was a woman, nobody ever knew. We knew she shaved.
You know, it's nice to say ladies and gentlemen, because most of the Friars' affairs are usually just men, which makes me remember the time the Friars bestowed an honor upon me many years ago. Johnny Carson was the MC, and the committee told him that ladies, as well as gentlemen, would be in the audience and please to not say anything off color. So Johnny said, ladies and gentlemen, what a thrill it is to present Miss Lucille Testicle. Good old Johnny.
Barbara, I say this publicly, I never liked you. I'm so fed up with this fakakta affair, you can't believe.
I don't know why, but I've always been considered, since I've been in this business, as one of the guys.
There used to be only men here. Now there's men and women, and it started when Phyllis Diller dressed up like a man and sneaked in one time.
I was the first woman to ever get into a luncheon stag all-male roast.
She came dressed as a man. She had a mustache, and she had a wig.
And this is when they even made all the waiters leave the room. It was so private.
Waiters, off the floor, please. Waiters, off the floor.
Now, one of the main problems was I couldn't go to either toilet for obvious reasons. I couldn't go to the ladies' room. They would scream thinking I'm a man. And I couldn't go to the men's room because I would have screamed.
I want security. So no one sneaks in again as a man. So gentlemen, for a security check, I'd like you just to reach over to the man next to you and hold his balls throughout the luncheon.
Congress passed a law a year or two ago back that women could belong to any men's club, that there's no such thing anymore as separate organizations without women. The Friars Club, we have women members now.
The club only had men as full dues-paying members.
I approached some people and asked them if they would be willing to sponsor me. I said, Milton, do you think I can become a member of the Friars Club? And he said, Gloria, not only will I make the motion for your admission, but I'll second my own motion. So with that, Milton made it possible for me to become the first woman member of the Friars Club in Beverly Hills.
I don't think women should belong in the Friars. Okay, now you're not telling me I'm anti-women. They don't belong in it. You know what they do? They spoil it.
I had been told that there was a reciprocal agreement by which California Friars would be able to use the New York Friars Club when they were there and vice versa. They didn't have any women members of the New York Friars Club at that time.
You women mean man. Me, you different. Body parts different. We different.
They refused to admit me.
Well, if you don't get the woman in, they're gonna go to Congress. Kiss my ass, you in Congress. You're not getting in.
So I did what any good feminist should do.
They will not serve me lunch because I am a woman and because the Constitution of the New York Friars Club does not permit women to be served at lunch.
When I got to the Friars Club, I attempted to go in. Henny Youngman was standing outside. He was throwing out lines. I was wearing red, and he was saying things like, you look like a blood clot, which was kind of cute. After a few jokes, he moved aside, and I entered the club. When I went over to the maitre d', I said to him, as I said yesterday, I'm here for lunch. And he decided to seat me and allow me to be served.
I think Gloria's a bright, bright lady. She accomplished what she wanted to do. She made the club bisexual.
We now have over 100 women members of the club. So all in all, that move was long overdue, and we're delighted to have the women here. Except for about 4 old guys that really can't stand it, but they'll get over it one day, too.
Of all the roasts that I missed that had a lot of controversy was the one where Danson and Whoopi Goldberg got up, and it was both racial and raunchy.
I'll tell you exactly what happened. The roast was one of the better roasts that we've ever had at the Friars. Whoopi was warm, she was a great sport, she was brilliant in her humor, she was just incredibly good. Ted Danson, I thought, was marvelous. I thought what he did was absolutely appropriate and perfect for a roast.
Please welcome Ted Danson.
When the roast was over, we walked out, we were congratulating each other. We thought it was a marvelous event. Next morning, we woke up to headlines.
It was all smiles last Friday as Whoopi Goldberg was preparing to be roasted by some of her showbiz friends. But when Roastmaster boyfriend Ted Danson appeared on the dais in blackface with white painted on lips, some of those smiles quickly disappeared.
What caused the scandal and what caused the big ruckus was one man, Montel Williams. He got up after the first couple of minutes during Ted's monologue, got up and left.
Part of what Ted's roasting was about being proud of me and who I am, and that he is proud to be my friend and walk beside me in life. But Montel missed all of that.
I don't know if he was sincerely wounded or if he was looking for some publicity.
Perhaps Montel's show is not doing as well as it could be. And this was his way of drawing attention.
Williams, a recent member of the Friars Club, announced he would resign from the organization in protest of a performance that he likened to a KKK rally.
If this is going to be the outcry after each Friars roast, the Friars will no longer be able to have them.
The club does not know what our performers are going to do or what our guests of honor are going to do. We don't censor anybody, and we don't edit them, and we don't see the material beforehand.
that Mr. Danson came in blackface was my idea.
In their first interview together since the roast, they spoke with BET exclusively about that night and about their friendship.
I picked jokes and racial jokes and sexual jokes that were so over the top that there would be no way I thought that anyone could construe this as serious.
It was not nearly so much the reference to race as was the vulgarity that I thought was beyond the pale.
I had a great time and am thrilled that RuPaul, dressed as a nun, stood up and humped the podium while screaming, "Give it to me, Big Daddy." I guess Montel missed that. Or Robin Williams, who spoke about my sexuality and said he opened my legs once and looked in and saw six guys and a Harley. There was a lot that went on at this roast.
In the wake of the controversy, the Friars have issued an apology to anyone who may have been offended. So after almost 90 years of roast, 1993 appears to be the first time the Friars got burned.
The card room, 15 to 20 people a day, it's not a huge thing, but it is comfortable for guys that are free and love to play little cards. Our games are very small here, because there was a problem many years ago with gambling out on the West Coast.
They had guys spying on each other's gin hands and stealing each other's money. There were guys that were accused of just stealing money by looking through certain cameras and seeing the other guy's cards.
At that time, I would say that the Friars Club possessed some of the sharpest, most clever, most ingenious, and yet honest and honorable, gin rummy players maybe in the world.
Every afternoon these people would meet, especially entertainers who work nights and not days, and play cards. So the Friars Club, it became quite a thing.
Johnny Roselli, you might say, was the representative, the West Coast representative of the mob in Chicago. He was a mafioso, or Cosa Nostra, a member of the family. Lo and behold, in the 1950s, or perhaps early 60s, Mr. Roselli, overnight, is a member of the Friars Club.
I don't think that the Friars did any great checking up on these people. They just recognized them as celebrities. But unfortunately, some of them were celebrities for the mob and not for entertainment.
The peephole scandal involved a mechanic who would position himself in the ceiling, looking down on the card players. And through special devices, the card player who was in on the scam would know what card not to throw or what card to throw. In gin rummy, you know, you throw the wrong card, boom, that could be the whole game.
It became a very big thing for 5 years. They were draining everybody that they wanted to drain. Through following Roselli, the FBI opened up this big can of worms of the cheating at the Friars Club.
It's a Saturday morning at 10 o'clock, 10:30. The elevator door opens and two men step out in white uniforms. These gentlemen were from the FBI. They had special instruments inside their cases, and they ended up on the ceiling, and they found all these various devices. And the Friars Club scandal just broke open the next day. And Phil Silvers, I remember, had to testify downtown in court. He had to testify. And the judge asked him, do you have any idea exactly how much money you lost? He said, well, let me explain it this way. To come here from Beverly Hills, I had to take a bus. And they all lost because the games were rigged.
It could have been several games. However, I'm such a poor player, my wife beats me.
Gentlemen, you understand the grand jury is investigating now, and we don't want to do anything that would impair that investigation. We've cooperated fully with them. Unfortunately, Mr. Martin was a victim of some improper activity in the club.
To become a member of the Friars Club, you have to be sponsored by two reputable members. So I was dying to know who his sponsors were. So I sneaked upstairs where all each member has a folder. So I arrive at the R's, and Roselli is gone. There is no Roselli.
Oh, yes, I think it was 1958. We honored Desi and Lucy. And that night had a lot of laughs and a lot of fun and a lot of pathos. The master of ceremonies that night was not MB, it was Art Linkletter.
Ladies and gentlemen, our most wonderful guy, Art Linkletter.
It was at the Hilton Hotel, and it was one of the biggest ones I've ever been to with the most important people. And they had a dais of at least 20 to 25 people.
Eddie Cantor had a program years ago, and on the show featured as one of his cohorts was the very wonderful comedian, and he was known as Park Yukakis. Park Yukakis, whose right name was Harry Einstein, was a great member of the Friars Club out here.
He was an unbelievable wit. I mean, whereas everybody needed writers, he never needed anything. He just did it himself.
He wasn't feeling very well. He had a little trouble with his ticket, with his heart.
And he had lost some of his luster and had not been working very much. And on this particular night, he was making his big comeback.
I want you to meet a great guy and a fine friar, Harry Einstein, Park Yukakis.
He did a routine about the Friars Club, which was the most hilarious routine I have ever stolen. I'm sorry. And he actually was the hit of the show.
But you must not think that the Friars Club is an easy club to get into. Quite to the contrary, it is most difficult. Before a prospective candidate has even issued an application, he must first satisfy us, beyond any question of a doubt, that he is either a resident or a non-resident of the state of California.
He was up there knocking him dead.
And he did about a monologue that lasted 10 minutes. Under normal circumstances, it might have lasted 6 minutes, but the laughs were so great, so impossible to believe, that as a result, it just stretched.
He then must be proposed by and then vouched for by at least two men who are listed in the phone book.
Ed Wynn was sitting on my right, and he said, "Oh, he's so brilliant." And I turned my head around to him that way, and I said, "You know, he writes all his own material." I was so proud of it.
He got a standing ovation. While he was standing up and bowing, he said, "Thank you, thank you," and they were cheering.
He walked back to the applause, sat down next to Milton Berle, and then suddenly put his head over on Milton Berle's lap and shut his eyes and apparently slumped down. And everybody stopped laughing and applauding because he had apparently fainted, or worse.
And then all of a sudden there was a hush. And as I turned back to the stage, there he was with his head on the table. And I can never forget that, you know.
I said, "Ladies and gentlemen, we have a little medical accident here for the moment. We wonder if anybody happens to have any nitro tablets, which are to pick up the heart." Well, the surprise of my life, big producers, writers, and stars came forward with vials of, apparently half the people in the room had heart problems.
And I reached into his pocket to get the little pill box of nitroglycerin, and when I tried to put it in his mouth, his teeth were clenched. I couldn't open his mouth.
Everybody was frozen in the room. The drama is unbelievable, because they knew what was happening. And I tried to get Lucy to unleash her fingers from that table to come back. And I couldn't get her. I couldn't move her hands.
It was quite a
quite, it just was a deadening blow to all of us. And that's when Milton Berle said to me, get up and sing a song fast.
Tony, get up, stall, do something to get their mind off it. Do something, sing a song. He says, all right. Tony Martin quickly, wasn't his fault, was improv, ad lib. He got up and sang, there's no tomorrow. I was so upset, I grabbed him by his pants underneath the table. I said, wrong, sing another. Now, get the picture. We've just lost Parkiakakis, and he's singing There's No Tomorrow.
Yeah, there were probably a couple of sympathetic heart attacks when There's No Tomorrow rang out.
And then everybody just sat. A few people left, but there were about 1,000 people in the room. Everybody wanted to know what the outcome was. And Parkey's wife went up to the dais. She sat at the very end, and when she saw the five doctors leave with their sleeves rolled up, very glum, she knew, and oh God, she let out a screech.
I think he was a heart doctor, and he came and he opened him up, and the fire department came and they tried everything. And the realization finally came, you know.
I said, Desi, we might as well call this evening finished, but there is one important piece of business we have to do, and that is you have to get the award for you and Lucy, the Gold Heart. And I handed it to him, and he got up and he said, 10 minutes ago, this would be one of the most important moments of my life and one of the most memorable awards we've ever had. Now, it doesn't mean a goddamn thing.
New blood keeps it alive. That's what we're trying to do. Get some new blood in. Keep it going.
I think the club made it an effort to attract younger people because they had to, because everybody was dying.
I find out recently that you joined the Friars Club, which didn't seem like you somehow.
If you love seniors, you're gonna love the Friars Club.
That's right.
Do you like older gentlemen?
A friar is like Milton Berle's a friar, you know, it's like...
Shecky Green.
Shecky Green.
The old-time comics have
old
this club.
School. Right, so I go to lunch at the Friars Club, and Lewis, also, who's gonna be out here, was there. And only at the Friars Club do you hear things like, tell Soupy that story. Tell Soupy. Because Soupy Sales is in the room, and he wants to hear that story.
One of the coolest things is that when you become a friar, you get a certificate of membership that I had framed, and my certificate is signed and sealed by Freddie Roman and Frank Sinatra, who were the dean and the abbot at the time that I became a member a couple years ago. I got Frank Sinatra's autograph. I mean, that's pretty cool. I'm sure Freddie signed both names, but the point is, it's a cool thing to have.
The best was when I was getting my pin or whatever. The guy said, oh, we're very happy to have this next woman, a star of stage, screen, never been on stage. Wonderful, wonderful actress, please, whatever. Jane Ann de Garofalo. Like, he didn't even know who I was, I don't think. Or,
he gave you a little twist.
Yeah, gave me a little extra something. It was hilarious. Sense. I mean, it was so funny.
They want to be part of a community. They haven't formed any club of their own. To my knowledge, there's no young comics club. The trick now is to get the Chris Rocks to join and the others who don't just see it as an old-time club. Because if you just stay an old-time club, you're going to close.
Steve Allen, Milton Berle. Strangely, there's no children in the club, but yet there's a diaper changing station in the mansion.
Now I know why they asked me to do this roast. They knew I'd make it.
Eddie Youngman, Gene Balos, I see younger faces on money.
This isn't a roast, it's a rot.
I remember when I was the youngest friar, and now I'm 74. You should even laugh when I'm just being serious. Because I might die before I get to my fucking seat. And then you'll sit there, your whole fucking life will pass in front of you. I had a chance to laugh. I let the old Jew down.
I find that the older comics, you know, Buddy Hackett, all of them, really want to take younger comedians under their wing and really want to pass on this legacy.
That's where I got the bug, because I actually went to the club and went into the dining room and sat there with Henny Youngman, who has been, to this day, is holding court there. I mean, he's very frail and very old, but it's almost like people bow to him when he walks in, because he's the what's left of that old-time shtick.
A hooker walked up to me, said, "I'll do anything you want for $50. I said, "Paint my house."
There's only one Youngman. There'll never be another one, this character.
Two guys in the gym, one's putting a girdle on his friend, said, "Since when do you wear a girdle?" "Since my wife found it in the glove compartment of my car."
I hope the survival of the Friars Club will be the enjoyment that younger people in showbiz will have by matriculating and being around our gang.
There's only going to be one Rickles and Hackett and Burrell, and for me to have worked with them, to improvise with them, you know, to have sparred with Milton Berle, you know, in his environment, and come out okay, is a feather I'll wear on my cap until I'm Burrell's age.
To me, it's like experience is like being around people with experience, you know, and connecting with them. There's no substitute for that. There never will be. And if you're an artist, if you're a performer, it's good to know what came before you, because there's nothing new happening. You know, it all comes from someplace.
Every once in a while, you get a young comic that'll come up to you and say, "Mr. Buttons, I want to be a comedian. Can you tell me what to do?" And I give them the same advice, everybody. I just tell them, "Stay out, kid. We got enough comics."
Last night, when we were young, love was a star, a song unsung. Life was so new.
Before the roast, you're all in a room. There's guys you haven't seen for a while, and there's some guys you think maybe next year you won't see them again.
The whole story is that I love the Friars Club, and as long as I live, I want to come here.
Where is that star that shone so bright? Ages ago.
Many of my friends are deceased. People are going all the time.
To think that spring had depended on
me. All I can say is we've lost an institution. I don't know what show business is going to be without Jack.
There are no nightclubs left. There's no show business, you know.
The great old-timers who had been around for years are pretty much gone.
The sighs and the kisses, the arms that clung when we were young.
Those were the beautiful dream people of Roastland.
I mean, I'm proud to belong to the club of George M. Cohan, Jolston, you know, the biggies, the big biggies.
It's kind of a bridge, you know, between the past and the future.
Hopefully, comedians and fans of comedy and show business forever will always point to the Friars Club as a great source of, you know, American culture.
Friends, to get things underway, will you all join in "Here's to the Friars"? All together. Everybody.
Years ago, they'd open up wearing monks' hoods and all that stuff.
What is the Friars song?
"Here's to the Friars." That song, you mean? That's about all I know.
"Here's to the Friars"? How'd they think of that?
Oh, I've seen it. I've heard it, yeah, many times. I don't know it.
don't even know their dance.
No. Of course, I don't even remember most of the songs I wrote, so that doesn't mean much.
Here's to the Friars, or something like that. I don't know, one of the worst songs I ever wrote.
Which, when we get drunk, we sing.
Here's to the Friars, here's to them all.
The long and the short and the tall. No, I don't know all the words.
Out on the road or here in the hall.
Raise high your glasses.
With love that inspires.
Because when we do it in an affair, the words are right in front of us.
And drink a deep toast to the boys we love most. A toast to all of the good friars, that kind of a thing.
I think to become a friar, everybody should have to learn the words to that song, including me.
Everybody, here's to the friars, here's to them all. Out on the road, or here in the hall. Raise high your glasses with a tear. To the boys we love.